Unsere nächste Rednerin fragt sich auch, was eigentlich mit den Geräten ist. Wer hat eigentlich die Kontrolle über die Lebensdauer meines Handys zum Beispiel? Entscheide ich das, wenn ich mir ein neues Handy kaufen muss, oder liegt das irgendwie gar nicht in meiner Hand? Fairphone bietet eine Alternative zu diesem gängigen Smartphone-Konsummodell, könnte man sagen. Und unsere Rednerin ist gestern eingeflogen von Amsterdam, und um uns zu erzählen, wie das genau funktioniert bei Fairphone, was das bedeutet und was das für ein Beitrag ist zur digitalen Nachhaltigkeit. Bibi Blekemolen, ich bitte dich auf die Bühne, come to the stage. She's going to tell us about the Fairphone and the modular system of the Fairphone and how it is a part of digital sustainability. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay. So, good morning, everyone. As Francesca mentioned, I'm from the Netherlands, so my presentation is going to be in English. I hope that's not a problem on this this morning, but I see a lot of faces already going like this. So my name is Bibi Blekemolen. I'm here to tell you about the story of Fairphone, which we started in 2010, initially as just an awareness raising campaign. We heard all about mine workers in Congo that were mining materials that were needed and somehow connected to the production of electronics and mobile phones. And we thought we have to tell people these stories. Mine workers should not work in these working conditions and not work at gunpoint to produce our electronics. For 2 years, we went up and down to the Congo, making videos, making photos, promoting these stories to consumers in the Netherlands and in Europe. But throughout those 2 years, we came to realize that it's nice to raise awareness, but more and more people started to ask, yeah, but there is no fair phone. There are no fairer electronics that take these issues into account. So we thought, yeah, we can protest for it and we can demonstrate for it, but actually what we need is not awareness, we also need alternatives. So in 2013, we started Fairphone as a social enterprise and using crowdfunding to start producing a mobile phone as a way to basically open up the production system behind that mobile phone and to uncover who are these manufacturers behind mobile phones? How do these supply chains from the mines to the end product actually look like? And what kind of opportunities do you have as a producer to make different choices and come up with alternatives, taking into account social and environmental considerations? And when we started, we thought, okay, it's nice that to maybe find some alternative sourcing initiatives. But at the same time, you can source fairer materials. But if you discard your product after 1 or 1.5 years, what is it worth to source all these materials? So also long-lasting design became for Fairphone a very important topic that we wanted to include in our mission for fairer electronics. And then also, we heard throughout the campaign stories about the conditions in the factories in China, where people have to work very long hours for very little pay. And we thought, okay, maybe throughout this opening up of the supply chain, we can actually look for suppliers that and manufacturers that want to do better also for their workers in the factories and to collaborate with us to come up with programs for these workers. And lastly, nowadays, how many people don't have, 4, 5, sometimes even 6 mobile phones lying around in drawers at home or hand them in at recycling points? But this growing amount of e-waste is piling up every day. So we also thought we're going to address some of these things. Okay, you can call us a bit strategic and naive. In the beginning, we had all these ambitions. And we very much realized that making a fair phone is very different than, let's say, making a fair banana or making fair coffee. If you talk about a banana, and even that is very difficult, but from a banana to arrive from a farmer to the supermarket takes like 5 or 6 or maybe 7 steps before you have it from the country of origin in your hands. But with electronics, a mobile phone is made of hundreds of individual components. Battery, the camera, LCD screen. Think about all these small capacitors and chips that are inside. And each of these components have their own supply chain. And in the whole supply chain, you see up to 30 or 40 different types of minerals and metals that are being used. Think about gold or silver, copper, cobalt, cassiterite, tantalum. Basically, the whole materials that you can think of, they are needed to produce electronics and mobile phones. Also, if you think about what it takes to produce these phones, and also at the end of life, once we're done with the phones, I heard the Stadtpräsident call the word wegschmeißen. There is this growing pile of e-waste that somehow can end up via second-hand market or traders or sometimes even illegal dumping at places that you see here on the pictures, which I took in Ghana a year ago, where people are literally dismantling old electronics and burning the plastics to get access again to these materials inside, which creates a lot of health problems and environmental issues. Well, this is a very grim picture that I've painted, but nevertheless, in the 3 or 4 years that Fairphone exists now, we have been able to be the first company that sources fair trade gold from Peru and sources conflict-free materials from Congo. We have been able to set up activities and projects in factories in China with producers that are making our phone. We have been able to collect 3 tons of e-waste from Ghana. So there is definitely a lot of things that you can actually do as a producer. But I think most significant for Fairphone is that we have designed a product that gives back ownership to people using that product. 2 years ago, we launched the first modular phone on the planet, actually. You see the modules on the pictures. It only takes 10 or 15 seconds to replace the LCD screen. And how many of you have seen or even experienced a broken screen, which for you has been a reason to replace your entire phone? Well, you can also just replace your screen or replace your battery and keep it then for longer. And very recently, 2 months ago actually, we have been able to introduce new camera modules, which means that people that bought their Fairphone 2 years ago can now, by just buying 2 camera modules, experience the latest technology for taking pictures while using their same trusted phone. So we really want to rethink this way of using your mobile phone and to allow people to actually keep it longer using design. And then, of course, it's very important that you make it possible from a perspective of hardware. But in the end, people also need to be motivated to use it longer. They need to feel that connection to their mobile phone much better. And you know, by the looks of it, it's a very alien product, you know, from again the banana, you know, okay, it grows on a tree, but with a phone, how is it made? Who is behind the making? What materials are inside? And those psychological elements, Fairphone really wants to push for informing people about how their phone has been made, and therefore also to grow that relationship and to strengthen that bond that people have with electronics so they also want to use it longer. And today, there are actually 135,000 people in Europe walking around with a Fairphone. I haven't seen one yet in the audience, but is there people? I see quite a lot. Actually, these 135,000 people, they are conscious consumers. And these people, by holding their Fairphone and knowing where it comes from, they can make other consumers more conscious. And thereby we can grow the group of conscious consumers that start demanding fair electronics also from other brands. Because Fairphone and even these 135,000 people, we cannot generate this system change alone. We need these bigger brands to collaborate with us and to join in on the wave and on this movement for fair electronics. And today I just found out from one of our partners here in Switzerland, Fair Customers, that as of today, the Fairford is also available in a shop here in Bern. So you can approach them in the lobby and ask where you can actually open up the phone and start learning about how it's made and how you can actually use it. So I hope that your discussions today will lead up to more thoughts about being a conscious consumer, being a conscious policymaker, and what we can all do to contribute to this trend and to do it towards the shift towards fair electronics. And I want to thank you for your attention and thank you for the invitation.
Before you leave. Yeah. Before you leave, we do have another minute or two, and I was thinking maybe I could ask you a quick question.
Yes, that's what I hoped.
Okay, cool. All right. So that's very intriguing, very interesting, the insights that you're bringing with us today. I was wondering the movement that you're trying to create and trying to attract this movement to create more devices and more brands that are sustainable in this way. Has it worked? Have there been any developments in this direction yet? Like, have you talked to Apple or Samsung or?
Yeah, so you meet these parties at conferences, and in the beginning in 2013 when we started, they thought this company is so annoying, and we even were told by them that you're so small, what do you know about this industry? It's so complex to change anything. We have very little idea how we can actually trace these materials back to their source, and how can you claim to be fair? And we said, we're not claiming to be fair, we claim that it's possible to open up that system and be more transparent about also the challenges that exist and provide a platform to collaborate. And actually, maybe some of you have seen that this week Greenpeace issued their guide for greener electronics. They issue that every year. And what you see is that actually the information that brands provide and the steps that they are being taken, they are huge steps that have been taken since a couple of years ago before we started. So yeah, I'm very happy to see this this trend, but nevertheless, there is still a lot of work to be done, I would say.
Okay. Yeah. So I guess the way to go is through the consumer and through the NGOs and other organizations, and not necessarily through Apple or the other.
Well, they need a market incentive.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if they see that there are consumers that are demanding it and wanting to buy these products, at the same time, if they see these steps as integrating fair trade gold being taken and being possible in the industry, then I can also think, this supplier that helped Fairphone to integrate that fair trade gold, I also might want to have a discussion with them how I, as Apple or as Philips, can also contribute to that. Yeah.
So it's 135,000 conscious, aware consumers in Europe. Are they all capable of just exchanging that camera module themselves? Like, do you have to have some kind of a technical background?
Yeah.
It seems
no.
Kind of complex.
No, I don't have a technical background at all, and I can quickly demonstrate how to at least replace the screen of the phone, what I mentioned, which is only in 15 seconds. For the camera, you need a screwdriver, and I don't have one with me, but this is the protective case, which you can very easily remove. Then the battery, of course, also very important that you can replace it. And the display, basically what we did is by connecting these clips, you can just slide off your screen in such a way. And on our website, you can...
That's pretty impressive.
And literally, yeah, you slide it back on, a new one, and you have a brand new screen again, as if your phone is new without any broken glass. So, yeah, those are, from a hardware perspective, things that you can do as a manufacturer. And as I showed on the slide here, it only has three little screws in the camera modules. Mm-hmm. So if you have a normal Philips Torx screwdriver at home, it's a matter of 1 minute, and you have upgraded your camera in your existing phone.
Pretty cool. Okay, maybe the last quick question. So we talked about the components, we talked about the sourcing, fair sourcing, we talked about labor conditions. What about the software? What about the operating system? What does that have to do with sustainability?
Yeah, that's a very important element for the longevity of a device. And it's not something that you can do on your own, especially as a small company, but over the last couple of years, we have been growing some expertise in-house that is pushing monthly security updates to at least keep it running smoothly. Plus, we have been the first company early this year to change from Android 5 to Android 6 completely. Mm-hmm. So basically to upgrade the entire software platform. Mm-hmm. We are looking into maybe upgrading also to future platforms, but there's a lot of complexities there, but still we're making an effort. Mm-hmm. And we're also releasing source codes, mm-hmm. which means there's quite an active open source community that is working with these codes and online pushes all kinds of nice developments there. So there are people walking around with a Fairphone that have designed their completely own OS to use it.
Okay.
And again, that's also, but to help people understand more and take ownership more of their phone.
Yeah, very nice. Cool. Well, we have a hack night going on later tonight, so maybe someone will bring their Fairphone and try to design a new program or hack or find a bug and fix it for you.
Oh, that would be great.
Very cool. Thank you very much, Bibi,
for
stopping by and introducing the Fairphone. Very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Have a good day.